energy. Energy is the working power in all achievement. Inert coal converts it into fire, and water transmutes it into steam. It vivifies and intensifies the commonest talent until it approaches to genius, and when it touches the mind of the dullard, it turns into a living fire that which before was sleeping in inertia. Energy is a moral virtue, its opposing vice being laziness. As a virtue, it can be cultivated, and the lazy man can become energetic by forcibly arousing himself to exertion. Compared with the energetic man, the lazy man is half alive. Even while the latter is talking about the difficulty of doing a thing, the former is doing it. The active man has done a considerable amount of work before the lazy man has roused himself from sleep. While the lazy man is waiting for an opportunity, the active man has gone out and met and utilized half a dozen opportunities. He does things while the other is rubbing his eyes. Energy is one of the primary forces. Without it, nothing can be accomplished. It is the basic element in all forms of action. The entire universe is a manifestation of tireless, though inscrutable, energy. Energy is, indeed, life, and without it there would be no universe, no life. When a man has ceased to act, when the body lies inert, and all the functions have ceased to act, then we say he is dead. And insofar as a man fails to act, he is so far dead. Man, physically and mentally, is framed for action and not for swinish ease. Every muscle of the body, being a lever for exertion, is a rebuke to the lazy man. Every bone and nerve is fashioned for resistance. Every function and faculty is there for a legitimate use. All things have their end in action. All things are perfected in use. This being so, there is no prosperity for the lazy man, no happiness, no refuge, and no rest. For him there is not even the ease which he covets, for he at last becomes a homeless outcast, a troubled, harried, despised man, so that the proverb wisely puts it, "The lazy man does the hardest work." In that avoiding the systematic labor of skill, he brings upon himself the hardest lot. Yet energy misapplied is better than no energy at all. This is powerfully put by St. John in the words, "I would have you either hot or cold. If you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth." The extremes of heat and cold here symbolize the transforming agency of energy in its good and bad aspects. The lukewarm stage is colorless, lifeless, useless. It can scarcely be said to have either virtue or vice, and is merely barren, empty, fruitless. The man who applies his abounding energy to bad ends has, at the very power with which he strives to acquire his selfish ends, will bring upon him such difficulties, pains, and sorrows that will compel him to learn by experience, and so at last to refashion his base of action. At the right moment, he will turn round and cut new and proper channels for the outflow of his power, and he will then be just as strong in good as he was formerly in evil. The truth is beautifully crystallized in the old proverb, "The greater the sinner, the greater the saint." Energy is power, and without it there will be no accomplishment. There will not even be virtue, for virtue does not consist of not doing evil, but also, primarily, of doing good. There are those who try, yet fail through insufficient energy. Their efforts are too feeble to produce positive results. Such are not vicious, and because they never do any deliberate harm, are usually spoken of as good men that fail. But to lack the initiative to do harm is not to be good. It is only to be weak and powerless. He who is truly a good man, having the power to do evil, yet chooses to direct his energies in ways that are good. Without a considerable degree of energy, therefore, there will be no moral power. what good there is will be latent and sleeping. There will be no going forth of good, just as there can be no mechanical motion without the motive power. Energy is the informing power in all doing in every department of life, whether it be along material or spiritual lines. The call to action, which comes not only from the soldier, but from the lips or pen of every teacher in every grade of thought, is a call to men to rouse their sleeping energy, and to do vigorously the task in hand. Even the men of contemplation and meditation never cease to rouse their disciples to exertion in meditative thought. Energy is alike needed in all spheres of life, and not only are the rules of the soldier, the engineer, and the merchant rules of action, but nearly all precepts of the saviors, sages, and saints are precepts of doing. The advice of one of the great teachers to his disciples, "Keep wide awake," tersely expresses the necessity for tireless energy if one's purpose is to be accomplished, and is equally good advice to the salesman as to the saint. Eternal vigilance is the price of liberty, and liberty is the reaching of one's fixed end. It was the same teacher that said, "If anything is to be done, let a man do it at once. Let him attack it vigorously." The wisdom of this advice is seen when it is remembered that action is creative, that increase and development follow upon legitimate use. To get more energy, we must use to the full that which we already possess. Only to him that is given, only to him that puts his hand vigorously to some task, does power and freedom come. But energy, to be productive, must not only be directed towards good ends, it must be carefully controlled and conserved. The conservation of energy is a modern term expressive of that principle in nature, by which no energy is wasted or lost, and the man whose energies are to be fruitful in results must work intelligently upon this principle. Noise and hurry are so much energy running to waste. More haste, less speed. The maximum of noise usually accompanies the minimum of accomplishment. With much talk, there is little doing. Working steam is not heard. It is the escaping steam which makes a great noise. It is the concentrated powder which drives the bullet to its mark. Insofar as a man intensifies his energies by conserving them and concentrating them upon the accomplishment of his purpose, just so far does he gain quietness and silence, in repose and calmness. It is a great delusion that noise means power. There is no great baby than the blustering boaster. He is but an infant mentally, and having no strength to do anything, and no work to show, he tries to make up for it by loudly proclaiming what he has done, or could do. Still waters run deep, and the great universal forces are inaudible. Where calmness is, there is the greatest power. Calmness is the sure indication of a strong, well-trained, patiently disciplined mind. The calm man knows his business, be sure of it. His words are few, but they tell. His schemes are well planned, and they work true, like a well-balanced machine. He sees a long way ahead, and makes straight for his object. The enemy, difficulty, he converts into a friend, and makes profitable use of him, for he has studied well how to agree with his adversary while he is in the way with him. Like a wise general, he has anticipated all emergencies. Indeed, he is the man who is prepared beforehand. In his meditations, in the counsels of his judgment, he has conferred with causes and has caught the bent of all contingencies. He is never taken by surprise, is never in a hurry, is safe in the keeping of his own steadfastness, and is sure of his ground. You may think you have got him, only to find, the next moment, that you have tripped in your haste, and that he has got you, or rather that you, wanting calmness, have hurried yourself into the dilemma which you have prepared for him. Your impulse cannot do battle with his deliberation, but is foiled by the first attack. Your uncurbed energy cannot turn aside the wisely directed steam of his concentrated power. He is armed at all points. By a mental jiu-jitsu acquired through self-discipline, he meets opposition in such a way that it destroys itself.